Hi guys and welcome to another vlog. Today we are reviewing the most packed segment currently, C segment SUV, and these are the top contenders because Kia Seltos obviously, and it has its own twin which is the Hyundai Creta, and here is the Honda Elevate, solely built on running on one single engine, two transmissions. And yes, we'll start by looking at the design. So the Elevate has a flat bonnet design. Here are the headlamps, LED of course, which comes from the base variant, LED indicators. The whole headlight setup comes from the base variant, which is a very good factor. Fog lamps in LED as well. The grille is posting a massive Honda logo, and obviously this is more of a SUV look that feels more sporty, and this feels more rugged. And here we have an under spoiler, which is part of an accessory. So yes, we have that grille, and as you can see, this grille is very big, looks like an MG car. So coming to the side, this car has Bridgestone Turanza tires, which are known for their silence on roads on high speeds. And it has a tire profile of 215/55R17s, and obviously the tires are very good. And now coming to the side profile, so basically this car has rear discs and rear drums, front disc, but the braking performance is just so good because it's the brake bite is very good, and the brakes are better than those of four disc of Kia Seltos. Even though Kia Seltos have four discs, it doesn't perform as good as the Elevate. Coming to the Kia's front profile, we have this knurled finish grille, 360 parking camera, LED DRL running through here, no projector setup, but it has LED headlamps. I would say the Elevate performs a little bit better at night. So yeah, we have LED indicators, dynamic swipe. We also have fog lamps, ice cube fog lamps, front parking sensors, there's the grille, there's the horn. And if we come to the side, yes, it has 18 inches, and this is the X-Line, so it get 215/55R18s. And if we see here, there is a camera, 360 camera, lane watch camera. The Elevate doesn't have the camera on the other side, so this has a 360 parking camera, and obviously a panoramic sunroof. If we come to the rear, we have discs. But as I told you, even though Elevate has two discs, it performs much better. Much better if we compare the specs. The braking performance is absolutely ridiculous, absolutely brisk. If we check out the rear design, so many people have called me out for comparing these cars better because people want to know, what do we like? Which design do we prefer? So I'm gonna come with absolute transparency here. I'm gonna be transparent with you all. I don't like the rear design of both of these cars because the connecting taillight design is not my persona, because I actually don't like it. If the Elevate would have left this part out, there would have been no problem. It would have looked much better. Also, the Elevate doesn't have a rear spoiler. This is not a spoiler. The brake light, the high mount stop lamp is there. Wipers, obviously. Washer. Again, this car has a rear spoiler, so it enhances the look by a tad bit. So yes, wipers, connected tail lamps, which honestly doesn't look that great, but I would say at night the Elevate's rear design does look good with the lights on, because it's obviously not connecting and I hate that design. So there is a diffuser treatment, fake diffuser treatment, and if we hunt for the exhaust, there it is. And there's the exhaust. Both of the cars don't show their exhaust out blatantly. Even in the Elevate, if we check out the exhaust, yes, there it is. We have four parking sensors here, four parking sensors there. Now we'll open the boot. Also, shark fin antenna. The Elevate has a boot space of 450 liters. Best in the segment, obviously the best in the segment. And yes, the space management is so well done that honestly, we won't feel that you can't feel that okay, I can't take luggage in this car because it feels like a boot space that you get in sedan. The ground clearance is high, the boot space is good, the rear seating space comfort is good, but there is a drawback to that. And we'll close the boot. The boot is heavy. Let's check out the Kia's boot, which can be opened via the key. Elevate's boot doesn't open with the key. See, here it opens. I have to hold and press it. Yeah, it opens. It actually didn't open. So here we have the Kia's boot space. Yeah, again, we have to say that Kia's boot space is not that big, obviously. It's 50 liters less of space, and the space management is not that great either, because they have not extracted the best space in the boot. But there is a subwoofer here, because this is a top of the line variant. Again, top of the line variant, but in manual transmission. And we'll close the boot. The boot is not that as heavy as the Elevate. Again, here we come to the side profile. It does look a little bit sporty, I'm not gonna lie, than the Elevate, but Elevate looks just so elegant, just so butch, because this stance is so butch, so SUV-ish, that I feel like I'm sitting in a higher end car, like the Ford Endeavor or the Fortuner. So yes, this flat bonnet obviously inspires a lot of confidence, unlike the ones which we see today, which have a curvy design. But if we come to talk about the dimensions of both of these cars, the Elevate does have a bigger wheelbase by 30 millimeters, and obviously Elevate has a huge ground clearance of about 220 millimeters, and Kia Seltos on the other hand has a ground clearance of about 190 millimeters, which is less as compared to the Elevate. Even after such ground clearance, Elevate feels very stable to drive, and we will cover that in the drive review. And if we talk about the height of the vehicle, 1650 is the height of Elevate, 1612-ish is the height of the Kia Seltos. No, 1645 is the height of the Kia Seltos. A little bit less, as you can see. Both of the cars get roof rails, which are not usable again. But this is covered in piano black, which does look good. And all the specs, the width is 1790-1800. So yes, the width is bigger in Kia Seltos. The Kia Seltos is bigger in length as well. So coming to the rear seat of the Honda Elevate, it's a very welcoming cabin, obviously, because it has that tan interior, tan finish interior here, leather finish here, soft touch. It actually feels soft. There is the plastic behind, which you can feel, but the plastic's quality is good. Not much flex here. And if you see the door handles, they feel a little bit better in quality than the Kia Seltos, but the Kia Seltos door handle look a little bit better. Usually it is deceive you by the looks of the material they use, not by the actual quality. Again, the quality feels good here. Twitters in the back. Stepping inside the cabin and closing the door. Yeah, that's a good enough thud. But as you can see, I have ample lot of leg room here still left. I can squeeze it like this, or I can sit like this, because this front seat is maximized to the rear seat, because it's all the way behind. And as you can see, twin AC vents, and there's a power outlet here, which is very outdated, and a little bit humped seat, but there is no transmission hump, it's almost flat. And as you can see, I can sit here. The car has enough width to seat three passengers, but no middle headrest, no center headrest, because obviously the center passenger doesn't get a head, as Faisal Khan says. Here we have child mounts and child safety mounts. Here we have twin cup holders, center armrest, which isn't touching the seat. And obviously, if you can see, that the cabin looks very premium, very very premium. And here the headroom is not lacking, because this roof is sloping to behind, and it gives me ample lot of space if I sit like this, or if I have to be upright, still it has ample lot of headroom. And the shoulder room is also good. I'm 5'11", and according to my height, there's enough space. If we talk about the foot room, yes, I can squeeze my foot inside there. There's enough space for two bottles, two 750 liters bottles for you. You can see the hinges, the quality of the hinges. They are very like gapey and very tight. If I talk about the Kia Seltos rear seat, yes, the door opens as wide as the Elevate. Here we have Bose sound system, which is very premium. No tweeters in the back. One touch up and down for all windows, obviously. Leather finish, but it feels plasticky, not as soft touch as the Elevate. Piano black finish, and again here there's a leather finish, so it does feel premium. A very good feature and unique feature of the Seltos, as I've mentioned it in previous videos, is the sunshade. Is a rear sunshade. The Haldron feels a little bit flimsy. Now if I sit in the rear, you can see that this seat is not absolutely behind, not adjusted according to my height. Here we have twin cup holders, armrest, if we keep that right ahead. Here we have the center passenger's headrest and a proper 3-point seat belt, which is a good feature. Have to give marks to Kia in this. And if I scooch here, see, here I don't have any leg room left. Seat is not all the way back. Even after dent, you don't get, obviously if we get cushions, you don't get enough leg room. Foot room is okay-ish, not that great. Under thigh support, you can see here, under thigh support is lacking, which was a little better in the Elevate. Not as great, but a little better. Obviously smart pure air purifier. We have the AC vents and two USB Type-C charging ports, which is a good touch. And Elevate doesn't have that. Obviously a panoramic sunroof, and this feels and brings a lot of airiness in the cabin because it's all black cabin. I personally prefer the Elevate's cabin, and you can see the handles are so flimsy. Here the quality of the buttons are not as great as the Elevate's. And if I talk about the headroom, let's talk about the headroom. You can see there's no sloping roof. Because of the sunroof, the headroom is hampered and not that great. And if you talk about the shoulder room, again, not that great. I'm sitting like this. Obviously, three passengers can sit, but they will be crumpled a little bit. Now, let's talk about the interior from the front seat and hop on into the front seat. Okay guys, so first thing first, we are in the cabin of the Kia Seltos. We'll start with the engine. The engine starts up pretty quickly, and this is the X line, so that's why you can see the all black interior around here. The roof liner is also black, and as you can see, the cabin looks very, very neat as compared to before. I didn't like the There's the sound system. As you can see, it gets a Bose premium 8-speaker sound system with the subwoofer. And obviously, this car is all about features. Kia, Hyundai, they have the same strategy to go all in the features. We have dual zone, climate control right here. We have a lot of buttons, so obviously it's good to not have touch controls, touch panels like VW or Skoda, which they are using nowadays. And people actually don't find it very intuitive to use. But you can see it's very clustered here. The the whole unit seems very old to me, but it's okay. That doesn't matter. You'll get used to it. Here we have a 6-speed torque converter. Now let's talk about which engine is this torque converter mated to. It's a diesel 1.5 liter engine, and obviously we can't directly compare it with the Elevate, but this diesel engine has a power output of 113 bhp, and I'll tell you something about this diesel engine. Not as quick as the Honda Elevate, even after having 100 newton meters more torque, 105 newton meters more torque. But till then, we'll cover that in the drive review. I'll tell you all about the features. We get auto headlamps right here, fog lamps, wipers are here. Obviously, the wipers are not aero twin, as you can see there. We get a HUD heads up display, and as you can see, it's projecting here from here, and it gives you a good, feels like you are sitting in a higher end car. And obviously Kia satisfied you with that. here's the 10-inch touchscreen, which has a lot to offer because, as you can see, I shifted to sport, normal, eco, three drive modes that this car gets. Traction, okay, obviously snow, mud and sand mode. It's not a 4x4 vehicle, but it's a gimmicky feature. Doesn't really matter if you have it or not. Because this car doesn't have a 4x4 setup. Here we have ventilated seats. As you can see, this feature is a boon for India because the summers actually drain you down and you obviously need this feature, which works really well in this car. There's this camera, as you can see, driver's rear view monitor, which is a good touch, and this is also in the Elevate, but it's limited to the half screen, and the screen's slick, very very slick. As you can see, the screen is very slick to use. I like the screens that Korean brands make. Hazard light switch. The AC's hazard light switch got stuck a little bit here. The AC doesn't have that dampening, and here we have soft touch, but you can feel the plastic. Again, dashboard. The plastic is of okayish quality. It's not having that much flex, as you can see here. The steering feels good to grip onto. D-cut steering wheel, all the controls, usual bits, paddle shifters, which the Elevate CVT does get. And if we talk about the key here, okay, this is the Elevate's key. In the manual transmission, we don't get the auto engine start-stop feature because that is only in the CVT transmission. Let's talk about one more feature, electronic parking brake. Now that seems a little bit higher end. You get it in Camry, vehicles like which cost around 30 lakhs. So that is a good touch. This also feels a little bit Range Rover-ish, inspired from Tata's design. They have also put this in the new Nexon. Let's talk about the armrest. Feels very, very flimsy. And obviously, here we have a lot of space. Let's forget the materials inside. If we talk about the seating comfort, obviously, the ride height is okay. Not as high as Elevate, but not as low as Tigon, if you say. There are electronic seat adjustments, A2 electronic seat adjustment, which is very good. And obviously, as you can see here, there's no lumbar support, but still the seats are cushiony, and they are a little stiff and a little soft, but the Elevate seats are very soft, not stiff at all. So now we'll talk about this feature, which is the IRVM. Obviously they get it. And sunglass holder, usual bits, LED cabin lamps, same as in Elevate, but the main feature is the panoramic sunroof. This car has a panoramic sunroof, which the Elevate misses out on. And honestly, it brings in a lot of air and makes the cabin feel a little bit airy because it's an all black cabin. Me personally, I like the tan finish. If you talk about the glove box, it's very light. The weight feels not that heavy. And if you talk about the plastic quality of the materials here, you can see the handle is very, you know, loose. This will fade away with time. I'm telling you by experience because I have a friend who has a Kia Seltos, and after 3 years, this knurled finish faded away. So quality can be improved. Steering is both adjustable for reach as well as rake. Yes. So we have traction control, HUD and auto start stop. If I remove my foot from the brake, the car will shut down. That there's a mild hybrid battery here. And if I talk about the adjustable seat belts, Elevate misses out on the adjustable seat belts. And here we have paddle shifter, which I discussed. Also, one more thing, let's show you the rear parking camera. This car gets a 360 degree parking camera. Obviously, experienced drivers like me don't need a parking camera in such small cars. You're not driving a BMW, which is of a 5000 millimeter length. But still, it's a good thing to have these features. For someone who is driving their first or second car and starting, obviously, there's a wireless charger here, which the Elevates get. USB-C charging port, which is a good touch, but it misses out on wireless Apple CarPlay. Wireless Apple CarPlay is not there, and that's honestly, in the lower variants of the Kia Seltos, we get wireless Apple CarPlay, which is very weird to me, why Kia has done this. But let's talk about the driving experience now. I'll put the car in drive, and off we go. We'll launch it one time from here. Let's turn off the AC. Turning off the traction control. The traction control is fully off now. And we'll get into the sport mode. And left foot on the brake, right foot on the accelerator, revving the motor, revs till 1800 RPM and off we go. So this car is powered by a 1.5 litre CRDI engine, and obviously it's the legendary diesel engine which used to come in the Verna and used to do a duty in all of the Hyundai Verna as well. This is a 1.5 litre engine, that was a 1.6 litre engine, it's obviously downsized, but as you can see, the 250 Newton meters of torque is just on paper, it's not reflecting here. The ride quality is definitely stiff because of the 18 inches. There is no grunt in the motor because 113 bhp, 250 Newton meters of torque. We just did a drag race between the Elevate and the Kia Seltos. To our surprise, the diesel lost both the drag races by a marginal gap of 3 to 2 cars, which was obviously a shock to us. The turning radius is decent enough, I would say. 5.4 or 5.3 is the turning radius. The Elevate's turning radius is obviously better because it's 5.2, which is very good. But this is also good as the steering has no feel or feedback because the steering is very light, but at high speed it just does not weigh up. And part throttle response is just very inadequate because this diesel engine is not getting that torque in. As you can see, we jumped over a high speed breaker and we felt that bump inside the car. I'll put this in drive mode and we'll turn on the AC. And now let's check if we roll the car from 30 km/h. This torque converter is a little slow and it takes so much time. The torque converter is sourced from Toyota and it takes so much time to pick up the speed. Obviously, mid-range is good. There is no top end in this car. Top end is absolutely dead, and Elevate obviously shows its true potential in the top end. Well, as you know, Ivy Tech nature, this engine is silent. According to the diesel engine, it's very silent because I obviously don't hear that much of the cabin noise until I push it too hard like this. If you drive it sedately, it's obviously very convenient and it can clock a lot of miles. So it can be said that this engine is reliable. That's not the very case for many Kia and Hyundai engines, but this engine is reliable because it's the diesel engine and it's very old and it has been doing the duty in a lot, slew of Hyundai and Kia vehicles. But horn is good, but see, this sound the horn makes, the quality of the steering is not that good. The steering is again not hefty at all. It's not. If I talk about the braking, we'll check the braking just once. We'll take it to 60 km/h, and here we'll press it. Obviously, the car felt a little unsettled from behind, but the disc, there are 4 discs in working, and I didn't think that the rear discs were working at all. The Elevate's braking feels much better. I'm not being biased, but it does feel much better. They have proven results. Autocar has tested the Elevate's braking, and yes, it surpasses even the Taycan and the Kushaq. So it's better than the Germans. But if we talk about the grunt of this engine, the diesel doesn't have that grunt. If you want to go for the 1.5 litre turbo petrol automatic, this car definitely defeats every car in this segment. It has a power output of 160 bhp and obviously a lot of torque, 260 newton meters of torque. And if I talk about the screen again, fluid to use, the gearbox is okayish. I would say you should go for the manual gearbox in this car, and we'll just park the car right here. The steering is light, but there's this vague feel in the steering. Overall, I feel a lot of body roll in this car, and obviously due to the 18 inches, the ride quality is very stiff. Features, everything, you get that in Kia Seltos, not in the Honda Elevate, but Honda Elevate is more for the matured customer. Coming to the interior of the Honda Elevate, so there's one feature that we haven't talked about, is that if I put my hand here, the car will unlock, request sensor feature, and to lock the car, you can walk away from the car and it would lock itself. And if you have that feature turned off, obviously you can lock from here. Now stepping inside the vehicle, we have quite wide opening doors and leather finish right here. This is this handle and that visible screw. So quality has been reduced. And if you talk about the panel here, we have one touch up and down for only the driver side's power window, which Kia has for all the power windows, obviously. And that's a feature lacking here. And child lock, lock and unlock. Again, ORVM controls, electronically foldable mirrors, obviously, in this segment. And speaker right here. It doesn't get a branded speaker system, but yes, the speakers are okay-ish. They are good enough. So here's the AC vent design. A little more retro-ish, in my opinion, as compared to the Seltos. So there's the traction control button. And as well as the headlight leveler switch. And if we talk about the steering wheel, obviously it's a very chunky steering wheel. It is both adjustable for reach as well as rake. So that's a good feature. Same in the Kia Seltos. The steering wheel is adjustable for reach and rake. If you talk about media controls, obviously cruise control comes here. ADAS functions, which is the adaptive cruise control and lane keep assist, as well as forward collision mitigation. If you talk about voice controls here, media controls, all that stuff is available to you. Again, if you talk about the toggles feel a little more grippy than the Kia's indicator stocks. So yeah, we have the auto headlight function, fog lamps, etc. And if we come to the side, we have the wiper controls on the left side. Here we have a switch to adjust the brightness of the instrument cluster. Here you can see the cluster will get very dim now. So that's a good thing to have here. And let's turn on the car. And if I show you the engine button, it's a little not in a very ergonomic place because it's very hidden. But yeah, there's the car rose to life. And that's the animation you get on the screen when the car starts. And obviously we have AC controls here, automatic climate control. This looks actually very premium, more premium than Kia Seltos AC climate control. See, we don't get dual zone climate control here, which we get in the Kia Seltos, but I like the buttons finish. The tactile feel to these buttons, even in the Honda City, the tactile dials were very good. So I like the AC controls better than the Kia Seltos because it looks really clustered in that car. Hazard light switch right here, no chrome finish on the AC surrounds. And if you talk about the charging ports, we have USB-A, two ports of USB-A, one for Apple CarPlay. We obviously have wireless Apple CarPlay and Android Auto. 12 volt charging socket right here, and two twin cup holders, manual gear lever. The gear lever is of a long throw, it's not a short throw gear lever. So obviously we get a wireless charger control here, and we have the mode to switch it off and switch it on, which is good touch. And handbrake lever, again, handbrake is not finished in the tip is not finished in chrome, little bit of cost cutting here and there. If you talk about the armrest, there is enough space to keep your stuff, your sunglasses, your microfiber cloth, etc. So yeah, the ergonomics are very good in this car. Steering is to my reach, and the seat adjustment is definitely not electronic, because as you can see, I'm using the lever, that which the Kia Seltos gets power adjustable seats. So that's a feature missing in Honda Elevate, but honestly, you'll get used to it, and you don't change your driving position every day. Height adjustable seat is obviously there. And if we talk about the screen, we'll listen to an audio very quickly. Audio quality is decent, and I think the tweeter, there are 8 speaker system, 4 speakers, 2 speakers at the front, 2 speakers at the rear, 2 tweeters at the front and 2 tweeters at the rear. No subwoofer in this car, but audio quality is still decent enough. Not as great as the Bose surround system in the Kia Seltos, but still great enough. If you talk about the sun visor, yes, we get a mirror here. which we don't get in the Kia Seltos. We get a mirror as well as a light on the co-passenger seat. We get LED lights, and they are not focus lights, but they are LED. And if you talk about the sunroof, it's a small one, not as big as the Kia Seltos sunroof, but it brings in enough airy feeling into the cabin, and you can shut it down as well. This is a little flimsy. The IRVM is actually very slick, no bezels as you can see here, and it looks very sharp with sharp edges. And there's one feature which is missing in this car, which is height adjustable seat belts. So this feature is honestly a miss for me, because height adjustable seat belts can be given in this segment, and the Kia Seltos has it, not in the lower variants but in the higher end variants. But Honda shouldn't have done cost cutting in these features. Some features are missing, some features are not. Some good features are there present in this car, like we have ADAS. For me personally, ADAS is not a very big deal, because it actually hampers your driving style. It depends on each and every person. We have 6 airbags. So now we'll start driving the car and see how it actually feels on the road. The indicator noise is not that bothering to me, but let's start with the first things, which is the turning radius of this car, which is the most impressive thing. As you can see, if there were no plants here, the car would have taken a turn easily. So the turning radius of this car is 5.2 meters, which is actually very less in this segment, like very good. So less turning radius is good, because your car will maneuver easily. And I've slotted the third gear. The passenger has not worn their seatbelt, so I would recommend them to wear their seatbelts at all times. Steering feel and feedback. The steering has ample lot of feel, unlike the Korean steering feel. As I told you, it's very vague. It feels very empty in my hand. Like, I feel like it's a very light steer. It is definitely light. Don't get me wrong, it is definitely light. But it feels very gimmicky and vague. So there's no weight to the steering wheel. If we speed up, if we go to a speed of 100 and 110 and cruising at highway, the steering doesn't weigh up. So here, we'll pick up. Okay, I slotted the wrong gear. Yeah, so here, the gearbox is a little notchy. This gets me to tell you that yes, the gearbox is a little notchy by Honda standards, but still very smooth. So basically, the gearbox is soft, but not that smooth, because the Honda City's 5-speed manual transmission used to be very smooth and very slick. So it was buttery smooth, and even after then, we have the 6-speed manual gearbox, and yet it doesn't feel that inspiring, because again, I've told you that it's a very notchy gearbox. So when you shift from second to third, it's smooth, but when you shift from first to second or from third to fourth, there's that little point in between where you can slot a wrong gear, where you feel like you're slotting a wrong gear. So we'll come to a halt right here. There's the lane watch camera, and that's a good feature which comes in handy. No 360 parking degree parking camera. We'll also show you the rear camera. We have 3 modes here. This is the normal view, this is a wide angle view, and this is the top down view, which actually helps you in parking in tight spaces. So yes, this is a good feature. So we'll do a quick 0 to 100 run here, and revving the motor, rev still 4000 RPM, and off we go. Second gear and 100. So we crossed 100 kilometers per hour in about 11 seconds. So the performance is very decent according to a 1.5 liter naturally aspirated engine. And we'll turn on the traction control for now. So the performance is very decent. It's not linear, definitely. You have a good low end punch, very good low end punch, and a good an amazing top end. Actually, not even good, I would describe it as an amazing top end, because from 4000 RPM the car start to show its real characteristic. Because when you come across, when you leave that mid-range, okay, the mid-range is decent enough, not that great, but when you leave that mid-range and you come into the top end of the car, you will feel the iVTEC roar. You will feel it get into the characteristic. And yes, this is a very refined engine. On the other hand, it roars after 4000 RPM, but otherwise it's very silent inside the cabin. Noise is so minimal. If I talk about the engine, but there's some pillar, not some pillar noise, but actually some wind noise, a lot of wind noise creeping into the cabin. And the car is using Bridgestone Turanza tires. These tires are very premium and they are known for the silence on roads. And there is proper insulations in the cladding, front cladding, and the rear tires. So braking performance, we are on a speed bump. Braking is very, very good. According to Honda standards, they are using just two discs. The Kia Seltos have four disc brakes and they don't have such a good brake bite. So yes, braking is better than the Kia Seltos. Steering feel and feedback is better than the Kia Seltos any given day. Gear ratios. First gear will take you up to 53 kilometers per hour. Earlier in Honda City, the first gear used to clock 60 kilometers per hour and the second gear used to go up till 100 kilometers, even 101 or 103. Now here, this is not the case because the second gear goes up to 87 kilometers. And yes, they have reduced, they have shortened the distance, they have changed the gear ratios, obviously, so that this is an SUV body type. So that is, it has decent pickup in hills, and it does have decent pickup. Even though the gear ratios aren't changed, it doesn't feel like there's a lack in power. According to me, this car is not underpowered at all. If some people would compare it to turbos, obviously turbos change the game after, like, that's a whole segment apart. But if you talk about the naturally aspirated engines, this engine produces a power output of 121 bhp, which is the highest in the segment, and it also produces 145 newton meters of torque, again highest in the segment in naturally aspirated engines, obviously. And yes, the performance is very brisk. Now I have slotted fifth gear and my speed is 28 kilometers per hour. So yes, the car is crawling easily without any vibrations or jerks. Now we'll come, braking is actually very good. Talking about the bonnet, the visibility of this car, the bonnet is very, very wide, like obviously wide, but also very straight, butch SUV feel. And it does inspire a lot of confidence because it makes me feel like I'm sitting in an upper segment car, which obviously has a lot to do with how they have constructed the bonnet, how they have constructed the whole boxy design of this car, and I definitely like it. And if you talk about the Kia's or Creta's bonnet, it slopes down a little bit to give it a sporty vibe, a sporty feeling, but this actually feels like a proper rugged SUV if only it had four-wheel drive. I hope Honda brings four-wheel drive into their future cars, whenever they are launching any other cars. The Elevate will get an all-electric version in 2026. So we'll see what features will it get equipped with in the electric variant. Now we'll take a stroll down a very narrow highway, and it has a lot of speed bumps, a lot of undulations. And if you take the car into some of these potholes, so the suspension is very, very soft. Even after it simply glides over these potholes, and the suspension is very soft, yet the chassis feels very stiff. Yes, that's right, I think this car is gonna score a good 4 stars, or maybe it might also score 5 stars in the global NCAP, because the chassis feels very safe, very stable. The curb weight of this car is 1258 kilos. So yes, if I take the car into the bumps here, I feel like I'm gliding over them. I feel like I'm gliding. Obviously, the tires are helping because the section is good. These are R17 inches. The ride quality is very, very good. Phenomenal, according to me. The best ride quality in this segment is in the Honda Elevate, and the second best would be the Grand Vitara, the GV, or the Toyota Highrider, because they have worked on the suspension as well. Now, if I want performance here, I'll slot the car into a lower gear, which might be third in the speed. and the engine roars back to life. So there is enough performance for your city driving, for your daily drives, and yes, this SUV will suit you. Unlike the Kia Seltos, the Kia Seltos has a really stiff suspension, as you guys know, because it uses 18 inches, and even in the 17 inches, the suspension is just too bad. So Honda has calibrated, has done an amazing job with such a high ground clearance. I think we need to step off from this road because there are a lot of bumps now. So even after a 220 millimeters of ground clearance, the Honda is stable at high speeds. There's minimal body roll. So now I'll be cornering this car, and I'll be showing you why I'm talking about the body roll being so well contained. There's the headlight. Obviously you can't see it in this setting in sunlight, and I'll show you the body roll, how it feels to corner this vehicle. Exactly, that's what I'm talking about. The passenger is definitely not feeling like being thrown around in the car because the body roll is very much well contained. Again, I'll keep on talking about the performance, the steering wheel. The steering weighs up pretty well at higher speeds, which the Kia Seltos doesn't. And in overall driving dynamics, this car is a notch above the Kia Seltos. Dare I say it? The horn is decent enough, and the horn is good. And if I talk about the wipers, I'll use the wipers really quickly. So there's a single nozzle on offer, yet it sprays the whole windscreen and cleans it in no time. There's that Japanese technology for you. I think it's time to end this vlog. I'll see you guys in the verdict, and yeah, that's it. Okay, so my final verdict is that this car is meant for sedated driving. If you want a good driving experience, go for the turbo petrol, but that's very costly. You will get this more economic 1.5 liter trusted and reliable engine, which has been running from a decade ago. 1.5 liter IVTEC, no turbo. This is obviously turbocharged diesel, but if you want to go for the naturally aspirated, I would say go for this. And even if you don't want, if you want driving dynamics more than power, because it's always not how fast you go, it's how you go fast. So I would prefer this. Obviously, I can say that the build quality of Elevate is a little compromised from Honda standards, but it's definitely better than this one, because this one scored 3 stars in the global NCAP rating, and I'm sure this Ace body structure will score better than that, at least 4 stars. We are expecting that. And this has more of an SUV stance and more of a good stance, as I talked about in the driving review. And in the end, I would recommend you the Honda Elevate if you want a more economical car, a more all-rounder packaged car, and if you want to go for the features, obviously there's Kia and Hyundai every day waiting for you. Thank you for watching this video. I'll meet you guys in another vlog, and till then, you can watch my other videos. Click the link. Bye.